on up in Chicago, I tell you. Oh, yeah. Boy, is that a rough town. Now, Lenny and I were leaving a hotel. We were going to take the L, and we asked the doorman, how long does it take to walk to the L? He says, I don't know. So far, nobody's ever made it. Oh, that's a rough town. All right. Anyhow. Yeah. Boy, you guys in Memphis got no sense of humor. Anyhow. Now, you guys, I'm sure, are rough on drums. That's for sure. And being rough on drums is basically why Tama's been a success in the last 6 years or so. We noticed that drummers were playing harder, touring was getting tougher, a lot more money was on the line, et cetera, et cetera. And drummers were looking for more versatility, more stability, more consistency from their sets. So basically we started with heavy-duty hardware, and our claim to fame is we were the first to make really heavy-duty hardware. We put it on the road with some of the hardest touring bands, with some of the most careless roadies, and a lot of it broke, a lot of it hung together, and we made a lot of improvements along the way, and it's to a point now where there really isn't a tougher drum set on the road. But we came here to see not just the drums, but perhaps the greatest natural drummer that this generation has produced, and that's Lenny White. And Lenny's checkered career has covered people like Miles Davis, who's on the legendary Bitches Brew record, played with Carlos Santana, with Return to Forever, and one of the originators of jazz fusion music. And Lenny's moved on now with his own group, 29, and a lot of you have picked up Lenny's record tonight. And those of you who didn't pick up Lenny's record tonight, we hope you go out to the store tomorrow and buy it. It's on Elektra Records. This new group is called 29, and without any further ado, I think I'll bring the man out here himself. Here he is, Lenny White.
Thank you. Thank you very much. I'd like to welcome everybody and thank you for coming out. You know, this is my first time doing something like this here in the Memphis area, and I hope it won't be the last. We're going to do a few different kinds of things tonight. I asked them to keep the house lights up and, you know, not put them down or whatever, because this is not really a show. It's like, I guess it's like instruction. You know, what I'm going to do is I'm going to play some, and I'm going to play with a rhythm section, and I'm going to relate how drums relate to the rhythm section. And because I think, first of all, for like young drummers, playing with a rhythm section, I think, is the most important thing, because anybody can play a drum solo. I mean, seriously, yeah. Actually, drum solos are boring. They're boring to me, you know, like guy plays a drum solo. No, but wait. Oh, thanks. And that's just the reason why I say that is that's just primarily because I think that, like, conceptually, everybody just thinks a drum solo is going up and playing a whole lot of drum licks, and that's not necessarily so. Also, what I really would like to say is that I'm just going to talk about drumming concepts and not so much tell you what to do, because as Jeff said, myself, I'm like a self-taught musician. I'm a natural drummer, and I didn't go to school and, learn all of the stuff that you learn in school, or the teacher tell you, yeah, you hold the sticks this way or whatever. And the thing is that not isn't necessarily the way to do it either, but we can just discuss drumming concepts, because a lot of people ask me, do I teach drums? And it's like, well, no, I don't, but I'll talk drums with you, because, again, I'm not going to tell you what to do. I could just maybe give you an alternative from the way that, like, you're doing something now to a new way of doing it. I think the best thing to do is whatever it is and get it so that it's right. Primarily, I'm a drummer that plays from the feet up. I don't play from the hands down. A lot of people play from the hands down. They got great chops or whatever. And when they play, all they have is chops. You know, it's like, wow, man, the guy's got great hands. But ain't nothing happening, you know. I mean, he's not playing and he's not relating to the rest of the rhythm section. the reason why I play from the bottom up is, like, especially in today's music, is based on the bass drum and the bass, so like it's from the bottom up. Earlier on, like playing bebop and music like that, you know, like the swing music or whatever, like the bass drum was very prevalent also, but it was just used for phrasing and, like, you know, where a phrase would end, you'd use an accent or whatever. But what I'm going to do is I'm going to demonstrate that, and I'm going to demonstrate it by playing with some friends of mine. Now, I haven't played with these guys before, and I want you to take that into consideration. So we're going to relate as a rhythm section. It's just like three people playing together. It's not like we rehearsed and practiced or whatever. So I'm like, it's very, very on the spot and spontaneous. I mean, I hate to do this, read names, but we have on keyboards Tony Thomas. And on bass, Sylvester Sample. Now, a type of music that is based on, gets its roots from the bass drum, is Latin music, like sambas, bossa novas, everybody, you know. Matter of fact, first let me ask, how many people here are drummers? Almost everybody. How many people are not drummers? What do you play? Bass? What do you play? Keyboards? What do you play? Bass? What do you play? Who? Bass and lead? What do you play? Kazoo? No, who's that? Oh, no, I'm on. Huh? Keyboards? Great. See, like, this is good because this just doesn't relate to drummers, it relates to everybody, you know. Now I'm gonna play a samba with these guys, and I'll just show you, I just want you to listen, maybe I'll answer some questions afterwards, and we'll see what happens, okay? Okay, vocal mic is on. It's working, everybody. The vocal mic is working. Yes, it is. I figured that before I played, I would talk a little bit about sitting behind the drum set, because that's really important, too. You ever, like when I was coming up, we had guys that played, you know, certain kinds, where they had their cymbals certain ways, and like the young drummers would look at him and, you know, they'd say, man, I really like the way that guy plays, you know. And like he'd have his cymbal set up way up here or whatever like this, you know. And guys would try to copy that, you know, like guy be playing this. Now the guy's been playing for like 30 years, right? And like the reason why he sets his cymbal up here is because that's what's comfortable for him. So he plays like this, right? So like the young guy who's been playing for 2 years, who likes that guy, says, I'm gonna play that way too. And he plays like this. But he doesn't sound like it. I mean, he can't play anything, you know? It's like, man, how come I don't sound like, you know, sound like that? Well, it's basically what it is like you gotta play and be comfortable for yourself. The way you sit, you should be comfortable. And also, like, it shouldn't be any extraneous movement. The way when you move, you should be able to make a sound. I mean, if you move here, you should be able to make a sound. You move here, be able to make a sound. You shouldn't have to reach out here, you know, because it looks hip or whatever. You don't have to do that, you know. Like, you just play so that, like, it's really comfortable for you. Where you sit, and you have to have good posture. I mean, you know, you see the guys play like this. Or, like, you know, when I was coming up, guys who play bebop or play jazz, they play like this. It looked hip, but it didn't sound like nothing, you know what I mean? I mean, and also, like, when the keyboard player says, okay, I'm finished taking my solo, the guy didn't know, because he's like this. Or the bass player's playing, he didn't know, I mean, he was in his world, you know what I mean? You have to always keep your eyes open and look and be observing with everybody and what everybody's doing. So we'll play something for you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. As I said, you know, we haven't rehearsed, we haven't played, and we're just getting together and doing this. The reason why I asked him to, and when I talked to Jeff, and we talked about doing a clinic, I said I didn't think that I wanted to go and play drum solos all night, because I don't think people would learn anything from that. I don't think you learn anything from me just sitting up here playing and playing a lot of stuff. I think what is important is for you to see how you can relate to the rest of the band, relate the drum set to the rest of the band. You know, a while back, people didn't think that drummers, you know, meant that much. I read an article where Max Roach said that back when he was playing, drummers were the people that hung out with musicians, you know. I mean, they weren't really thought of as musicians. And that's not fair, because the drums are the heartbeat of any band. I mean, the drummer is the heartbeat of any band. How often have you gone to a concert and the guy says, how was the concert that you went to last night, man? How'd the band sound? He said, well, the guitar player was great, and they had some nice tunes, you know. But the band didn't sound that good. In the same situation, you go to a concert, the guy say, well, how was the band? He said, man, the band was kicking. You know, maybe the vocals were a little bit bad or the guitar player was weird, but the band was kicking. And usually when that happens, that means the drummer was kicking. The drummer was like really punching and making the band work, you know. I mean, how many of you play in bands now? All right, okay. I mean, so like, you know, I know it's difficult and it's hard for you to relate sometimes when like the guitar player is out in front and like he's doing all the licks and making all the moves and the girls are going, they're going crazy and everything, and you're sitting back there going, sweating and losing weight, you know? But I mean, you know, the thing is, again, you guys are the heartbeat of the band. You are what makes the band work. You're the traffic light. You're the traffic cop of the band. You know how, like, at an intersection, you know, you have two cars coming together, and, you know, like, if there's nothing there to direct the flow of traffic, they'll crash. And, like, you have to be the ones that direct the flow of the music. You have to say, okay, now the music is going to make this change, or now the music is going to make that change, you know. And it's your responsibility. But that doesn't necessarily mean that you are the guy that has to have it so when the piano player is playing or guitar player is playing and he misses a cue and you're not there, he turns around and said, you're wrong. That's not the case. I mean, like, you hold it together, but, I mean, it is it's full responsibility on everybody, because it's really a drag to play with people who have to count it and count it in their head. I mean, you lay it down, they should know where it is. But I mean, I must emphasize that you are the heartbeat. You are the leader of the band, actually. You know, if the band sounds good, when you sound good, the band sounds good. When you don't sound good, the band doesn't sound good. You know, so like, you gotta really keep that in mind. And you do have to relate it. I mean, because rhythm section is it. The rhythm section is the heartbeat. About, let me see, I don't know, 1930s or whatever, when swing music was out. You guys know about swing music? You know, like, you know, Tommy Dorsey, Glenn Miller, and all those bands, those big band, jazz bands. I mean, you know, when they were playing, they would play with the bass drum, you know, be like this. And, like, that would be the heart. I mean, like, you know, everybody in the band would listen to that, and that would be it, you know. And now it's 1980, and it's back again, you know. It's playing disco. Everybody's going. You know, I mean, the drums, man. The drums are the most natural instrument next to the voice. The voice is the most natural instrument. Drums is second. And, like, there is that thing. You ever have your drums set up or whatever? You go to a drum store. Go to a store, any kind of store. And, like, everybody walks by. I don't care if you're an accountant or anybody. You walk by and, like, somebody always has to tap the drums, you know? You see Johnny Carson every night with a little pencil going like this, you know what I mean? Tapping on the drum, on the table, you know what I mean? Everybody is a drummer instinctively, you know. And it's just how you relate what you have to the rest of the music and the rest of the band. Now, we'll play some more. And I know a lot of times when I ask young drummers to come up or whatever, and I say, like, why don't you come up and play? The first thing they do is they come up and play a drum solo. They don't play any time. They don't groove, you know. I mean, and that's really an art to doing that. It's just grooving, you know. As I said, back in the old days when bebop was happening, you got guys like Max Roach and Philly Joe Jones and Elvin. You guys know about these guys? Yeah, you know about them? That's good. I mean, I'm just checking up. I don't know. I don't know. I'm just asking you, checking up, see if you know, you know. But like, those are the guys that like paved the way and made drums what they are. And in playing bebop music again, the bass drum was used to accent the phrasing. A lot of today's music, people don't play phrases anymore. They play licks. You know, like you get a guitar player, he plays all the slick licks. But like, there's no phrasing. And in bebop music, there was phrasing. You know, like you play an 8-bar phrase, 12-bar phrase, 4 bars, or whatever. It was a phrase, and like at the end of it, you would accent it and you would end it. But nowadays, it's not so much the same, you know. And that is something to learn. That is something to do and practice and try, is try playing phrases and playing in a situation where you accent and emphasize phrases. And the best way to do that is to play with a rhythm section. So what we're going to do is we're going to play an older piece of music. We're going to play some like bebop type music, straight ahead jazz, you know, hey. And we're going to do a tune based on rhythm changes entitled Oleo. So we'll play it for you and I'll show you what I mean.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. You know, like playing that music is I really enjoy playing that music because when I was coming up, that's the music that I heard most of the time was jazz music. And what would happen to me is I'd have so much anxiety to play it right, you know, like to try and do it and try to emulate, you know, guys like Philly Joe and Max Roach and everything. That when I would get out and play live with guys, you know, because I would practice in my basement, you know, I'd sit down and play all the records, you know, and, you know, put the record player on and practice all the licks and, yeah, man, I got it right, yeah, it sounds good, you know. And then, like, one of the drummers that I listened to religiously was Tony Williams. I mean, Tony was great, you know, like, he was my idol. And I would practice, try to sound just like Tony Williams. And then I'd learn all of his licks and everything, and I'd get to the point and I'd say, man, you know, I really do sound like Tony Williams, man. I mean, like, I was like, I know I sound like Tony Williams, man, it's happening. You know, I know the deal, you know what I'm saying? You know? And, like, I said, yeah, man, you know, like, so I'd go out and I'd be bad, you know. Yeah, I'm ready. What you want to play? You know, you want to play, yeah, that tune that Tony played? Yeah, I know it. And I'd play it, you know, like, yeah, it'd be slick, play all Tony's licks. Guy said, yeah, man, you sound good, man. You sound just like Elvin Jones, man, you know. It's great, man, you know. And I said, wow, you know. So that it just goes to show, you know, like as much as you think that you, you know, sound like somebody, you know, somebody else may hear you may sound totally different. And also, I don't care if you learn everybody's licks or whatever, it doesn't necessarily mean that you're going to sound like that particular guy. Because of one thing, placement. Placement is a very, very important thing in playing in a rhythm section, in playing the drums, playing any instrument. But like, placement is what makes you personal. It's what makes the difference between a Tony Williams and an Elvin Jones, because they're playing the same rudiments. They're playing the same thing. But it's where they place them in the phrase, or where they place them within the music, which makes them sound like themselves. And everybody has influences. And like, you have to get to that point where you play and the influences are there, but you play through the influence. You know, like if there's somebody that you like, a particular style of music that you like, it's okay to play like that guy, you know, and learn from him. But at some point, it's going to have to be a turning point where it's going to be you as an individual playing, as opposed you playing through. It's all right to play through somebody, is what I'm trying to say. It's all right to say, I know guys, man, say, yo, man, I got my own stuff, man. I don't sound like nobody, you know? I don't sound like nobody, man. I got my own stuff, you know? I'm bad, I know it, you know? And that's not true. How can you say that, you know? It can't be, because, like, the rudiments, I mean, are based, it's just doubles, singles, and flams. Everything is based on that. So when you go to play, I mean, how is it that you're going to not sound like anybody when, you know, like there was 15 million people before you, and, you know, you got to just use them as a reference and use those people as an influence. So, like, there are, you know, those guys that do say that, say, like, they don't sound like this, they don't sound like that. But it's okay, is what I'm trying to say. It's really okay to sound like somebody. It really is. Because after a while, you'll just play through that. Hopefully, you'll play through that. And, you know, again, you go out and you play with a band, and you listen to a record, and you learn the record, you learn all the licks on the record, and it'd be exactly like the record. But when you go out and play, it's not those guys that are playing on the record. It might be totally other different people. So, like, you have to relate that to that, you know, that situation. So those are things you have to worry about. I mean, you have to think about. Attitude is a real important thing. You know, a lot of people have attitudes. I mean, that's what stops people from playing music with other people. There's no reason in the world why Jeff Beck shouldn't play with Herbie Hancock, or Herbie Hancock play with Elvis Costello, for that matter, you know? And people say, what, Herbie Hancock with Elvis Costello? Come on, I mean, you know. I mean, but, like, it's just attitudes. That's all it is. Because, I mean, they both play music and they're both relating, so, like, it doesn't really matter. You know, they're doing the same thing, is what I'm saying. You know, it's like you shouldn't let something else outside of the music stop you. I mean, if you want to play, and you want to play a certain kind of music, and guy says, well, let's play this. And you say, man, no, I don't want to play that kind of music, man. That's not hip or whatever. I mean, you know, it's all music. It's okay. I mean, learn to play and adapt to as many kinds of music as possible, as much as you can, because those are the guys that are always going to be on top. And the guys that, like, don't want to play that, or, like, working on some of their own slick stuff, are going to be the guys that are going to play in their basement. And the guys that don't, and the guys that, like, want to learn and play as many different kinds of music as they can, are going to be the guys that have the gigs all the time. So, like, you know, and there's always the drummer saying, oh, man, that guy can't play, man. I could play better than him, man. You know, like, I should have the gig. But he's the guy with the attitude, you know. So, like, you know, just cool it out and just, you know, practice what you want to do, and, you know, get to the point where, like, you can relate to all different kinds of music, all aspects of music, and, you know, cancel all of the bad vibes, all that stuff, all of the stuff that doesn't have anything to do with music, you know. Learn your craft, learn your instrument. As far as practicing is concerned, I don't really have a particular point about it where, like, you have to practice 8 hours a day, or you have to practice 6 hours a day. You know, I think that if there's something that you want to learn, you see somebody doing something that you want to do, or there's something, a lick, a particular lick or whatever that you want to learn, you practice that until you can master it. And if that takes 12 hours a day for 12 weeks, then you do that. I mean, you should be motivated enough to practice. I mean, it's not a ritual where you have to practice this or practice that. You get to that point, you practice it until you master it. And then once you've mastered it, you go on and do something else. I mean, again, this is just my personal viewpoint on it and my concept of it. You know, like, you may have teachers that say that you should practice, and there's nothing wrong with that. There's nothing wrong with that. All I'm saying is that, like, for me, when I wanted to master something, I practiced it until I mastered it, and however many hours a day I could, that's what I did. I practiced it however many hours a day, you know. So that's something about practicing. Again, I must emphasize, like, playing the groove. A lot of cats think, no, because you see all these drums here. Another fallacy of the young drummers is that these drums, I got to play the drums. See guys with, like, 79 drums. No, seriously, you know what I'm talking about, you know? Now, it's okay to play 79 drums if that's what you hear. But what is not right is to have a setup of 79 drums and you only play three. I mean, you can only play three. Now, what is okay is that, like, if you have 79 drums around you and you're playing some music where, like, you're just supposed to groove and playing a snare drum and a hi-hat and a bass drum, that's what you should do. But, like, there's this thing that, man, guys have all the drums around them and they say, I gotta hit every drum, man. You know, it's like, if I don't hit this drum over here on the left, somebody out there in the audience is gonna say, I can't play. Because, or, you know, you get the feeling of, like, you know, like, you got all these drums around you and you play and you come off on the set and you walk around and you think somebody's gonna say, hey, buddy, you missed the fourth drum over there. You know what I'm saying? You didn't hit it. You didn't hit it, you know? So you can't play, man, because you didn't hit that fourth drum. You know what I'm saying? You don't have to. Don't worry about it. Don't worry about it. I mean, it looks nice. And that's another thing. Like, drums have become cosmetically nice. I mean, like, blue drums. You know what I mean? I mean, like, they're pretty nice, you know? Like, when we talked, the Tama people talked, I said, like, I'd like to have some blue drums. They said, blue drums? Really? Turquoise drums? I said, yeah, well, why not? You know? And it's okay. It's acceptable now. I mean, drummers are, again, coming more to the forefront, you know? I mean, like, so if I wanted to have blue drums with orange hardware, it's cool. You know, it's all right. You know, the guitar players have all weird-looking guitars and everything. Drums are supposed to be, you know, a certain color. What? No, it's okay. I mean, it's all a part of relating, you know, your instrument to the audience. I mean, to people. You know, like in soloing, you know, guys, you know, play drum solo. I mean, and the drum solo is sad, but the drum set looks good. You know, it's all right. The drum set looks good. It's like, you know, but it's. I mean, it may sound that, like, I'm, you know, talking and saying that, like, everything is all right. That's not what I'm saying either. All I'm trying to say to you is that, like, a lot of times people have attitudes about things that have been instilled for a long time. You know, the drummer sits in the back, the drummer plays the beat. You know, the drums are supposed to be a certain color. You're not supposed to have, you know, nice looking drums. I mean, you know, you got 79 drums, you're supposed to hit every one. You know, all those things, you know, you don't have to do that. It's okay to have the alternative. I mean, and the best thing to do is to play the groove, you know. So what we're gonna do, again, we haven't rehearsed it, so we're just gonna play some music that we can groove on. And again, I'll just show you how I personally relate to the rest of the rhythm section, okay? Oh, he didn't have any sound. See, that's another thing, you know. We don't have to turn around and call on Con Ed, you know, because our sound is here, you know, with this. Okay, he has sound. Hey. Okay. Again, I must emphasize that, like, we're improvising all the time that we play, you know, like, we didn't put it together or anything, so, like, we're just improvising as we do it, you know. I'm going to play some more because I feel like playing, and what we're going to do is what? Funk? Well, see, another thing, see, like, you don't play funk by yourself. And when you work things out, see, a lot of people think that funky music or funk music is not, I don't know, esoteric music. Well, basically, it isn't, because it acts on the primal instinct, you know, makes you move. But that stuff is really worked out, you know, and like when you get a rhythm section that's locked together, you get, you know, bass player and the drummer and the guitar player and the keyboard player to lock together, that's when it's really funky. It's not funky when I just play by myself. But I tell you what, what's your name? Michael, why don't you come on up here for a minute? No, wait a minute. Now he looked at me. I said, why don't you come here for a minute? He said, who, me?
Yo, man, I didn't mean nothing, man. You know, like, all I was asking for you to play some funk, man. I didn't really mean nothing.
No, seriously. And I like you and about, I mean, how many guys really feel so like they keep good time? Okay, why don't you come up? You come up. Did you raise your hand? Come on. Who else? Okay. There's a guy up there going like this, pointing to his mother, man, saying like, come on, there, man. I need two more guys. Okay, come on. All right.
Simple.
Now, when I want three guys over on this side and three guys on this side. Okay. No, there's not gonna be enough room on here, so you got to stand down here on the floor. Three guys on this side and three guys on that side. Okay.
Oh, there's four guys.
Okay, well, five. Okay. Now, I'm just gonna play with you guys. What I'm gonna do is, like, you guys are gonna be my metronome. And I'm just gonna play, okay? And so all I want you to do is come on over here, man. What is this? You're in the twilight zone back over there or something. Man. Come on, get over here, man. Come on, I'm not gonna bite you. Come on, it's cool. It's all right. And like all I want you to do, let me see. Why don't you strike up a group? See, I would ask everybody to do it, but it'd probably sound like a parade, you know, like clap, you know. So, like, I've just got, like, what, seven guys here? One, two, three. Seven, right. We got seven guys here, and they're going to act as my metronome, and I'm just going to play some with them, okay?
Thank you.
Let's give them a hand. Come on, man. Now, let me just explain a little bit about what I just did. I just basically worked from a theme. Like, I played a drum solo, but it wasn't a drum solo that was full of a lot of rudiments, which a lot of people think a drum solo is. That's all they think it is. It's like, which, you know, a lot of them are. But again, my concept for toward playing the instrument isn't from a rudimental approach. I feel kind of weird saying that here. In this is the Memphis Blues are here, right? And it's like a marching band, right? Is that right? I mean, I feel kind of weird saying that in this hall because these walls have heard all of these rudiments. The walls have eyes, you know what I mean? Yeah. But again, I must emphasize that like my approach is a little bit different. It's not rudimental. I play from sounds and particular patterns that I hear, you know. And I just basically worked off of a theme and soloed and improvised on the theme. It was, you know, the theme basically was just this. I'll kind of slow it down. If you count, this is where the beat is. Again, I'll slow it down. So it's like, sounds so weird is because there's no backbeat. Usually a drummer plays, the backbeat is always. I mean, that's where the beat actually would be. It's just that I moved the backbeat around. But like, see, these guys come. It looks spastic, doesn't it? Nothing, man. Nobody really notices, nobody said anything about it. But I am playing weird, aren't I? I'm playing backwards. Anybody really notice that? You notice, hey, you noticed it, great. You noticed it too, right? Okay. I've always played this way. I'm ambidextrous, but I don't play right-handed hardly at all. The only beat that I've ever played right-handed is Lopsy Loo. You know the Lopsy Loo beat? That's the only beat I've ever played right-handed, but everything else I play left-handed. And I set up the drums for a right-handed drummer, but I play backwards. Usually, you guys would play like this, wouldn't you? And you play the hi-hat like this, right? You cross. But I don't do it that way. I'm not cross. This is, to me, the most natural way to play because I don't have to cross over. I don't have to play like this. You know, I play like this. And it was kind of weird, you know, like when, I was a real advocate of Tony Williams-dom. And when I used to see him play, like, you know, he'd have his big cymbal over here and he'd be playing and like he'd do some stuff like off of the cymbal and it'd be slick, man. I said, man, how could I do that? I can't do that because I play like this. I mean, is there any way that I could try to? It don't look, I mean, I tried it on a gig and it was really embarrassing. So I didn't do it anymore, you know. See, things that look slick not necessarily sound like anything, and you might find yourself very, very embarrassed and might not get any more gigs in life and become a plumber instead of a drummer, you know what I'm saying?
So, I mean, it's really not cool to embarrass yourself, especially when it means you're getting some money. You know what I mean? Like, and it means you might not get any more money, you know, working at it. So, stay at home and practice it before you go out and try it on somebody or some other people, you know, because the gig you save may be your own, you know. So, I think we're going to play some more. We'll just play a groove. I like playing grooves, you know. Since this is Memphis, maybe we'll just play a groove for a minute, just play a groove on Memphis Underground. Let's see what happens. You know?
Thank you.
Yeah, it was fun. Fun. Again, man, just grooving. You know, sometimes it's all right to groove. And listening, there's one thing I have to say that I've learned in the past and playing a lot of different kinds of music is this applies not only to drummers, but it applies to like everybody. It applies primarily to rhythm section players, though, I would say. The less you play, the more opportunities you have to play. Now that might sound like double talk, but let me explain myself. The less that you play, I mean, like when somebody's grooving and you're playing a groove, the less that you emphasize playing a lot of different kinds of stuff in there, or like, you know, putting in a little beat here or a little chord here or whatever, bass, guitar, or drums. It doesn't leave any room for anybody to play when you clutter up all the holes, you know? You have to leave some space. So the less you play, the more opportunities there are to fill up those spaces. Not necessarily you, but everybody else, you know? I mean, and like once you get to a point where like you're playing and you're used to playing with people, you'll be able to find your holes, find your space. It's like playing football, man. I mean, how many guys here are into football? Two guys, man? Are you serious? What about basketball? Two guys again, basketball? You guys are not athletic at all, huh? What are you into, jacks? What about jacks? Checkers? You know, oh, the guy over there is into checkers, huh? Okay, right. No, but see, I mean, the reason why I said football, because I was going to use an analogy, man, it's like finding a hole, you know, like you see Earl Campbell run, you know, and like, you know, there's a hole. I mean, they open a hole for him and it's not happening, so like he goes around another play. You know, he'd be knocking people over anyway, so it doesn't really matter. But the thing is like to find your hole, find a space, you know, and you don't necessarily have to always look for it because like it'll be there a lot of times, you know, because of the fact you're playing with a rhythm section that people do lay back and give you opportunities to find stuff. But if you're playing with a rhythm section where everybody's always constantly playing, and it's like this all the time, there's no room for anybody to play, you know? So I think that's an important point, is like the less that you play, the more opportunities you have to play. We're gonna play one more piece of music. I'm gonna play with the guys. And then maybe I'll play something by myself, and then I'll answer some questions. I know you guys have questions, right? You guys have questions, right? You got a lot of questions, right? Like, I know somebody's going to ask me, what do I do for a living, right? No. Okay. what we're going to do is, I like another groove that I really like playing on is a shuffle. I'm going to play on a shuffle groove, and we're going to let Sylvester play some on bass. And then I'm going to play on top of that and superimpose some rhythms on top of that and see what happens, okay? Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. Again, you know, like when we, Tama people and I talked, you know, about doing clinics, they said, well, you know, we'll do some clinics. And I said that I wanted to do it with musicians because it would really be a drag if I played drum solos all night, you know. And I know a lot of people would be sitting back there going, you know, I don't care how good you are. If you play drum solos all night, I mean, people are apt to get bored, you know. A lot of times, drum solos are boring, you know. I know earlier on, when I would play, I had worked out and I'd gotten to a point where I really felt good about playing with a rhythm section. And I hated to play a drum solo, you know, and I'd play. I mean, that sounds odd, you know, like guys play drums and like, man, they just can't wait to play the drum solos. Like, they're playing and like, man, you know, come on, I want to play the drum solo, man. Give me, boy, I could tear this tune up, boy, I know it, boy. Just wait till I get to my part and it's going to be me and the drums, Jack, you know. And they get to their part and they play a drum solo and it sounds good, but the whole rest of the song sounded horrible. And then, like, nobody could play, you know, because they'd be so much anxiety, they'd be pent up, they'd be playing up. And the situation was, man, I said, well, I did it backwards. I got my rhythm section playing pretty much together, where I felt comfortable about it. And when it came to doing solos, I was like, oh, man, you know, God. Well, I'm not going to play that long, man, because, you know, I didn't, you know. But what I did in doing that is, like, I just adapted another method to playing drum solos, and that is, no matter if it was something that I heard with the rest of the band or whatever, I would just use a form, just like a guitar player or a keyboard player, horn player would play a form. He'd play A, B, A form. I'd play a form too, and I would find a particular motif or something that I would play off of, and I would adapt it to my drum solo. So like there would be a theme, there'd be a variation, and I'd come back to the theme. Just like if you were writing a piece of music, you'd have a theme, a variation, a theme, a variation. So I adapted this concept to playing a drum solo. And there was a piece of music that I wrote around a drum beat that was on an earlier album. And what I'm gonna do now is I'm gonna play a short solo based on that particular motif or that figure. And then afterwards, I'll ask some questions and answer some questions about it. You guys are asking questions. I'm not gonna ask some questions. You guys are. Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. Thank you. Now, I'd like to throw myself to the lions and ask if you guys have any questions. How, say that again. How do I feel when I'm working with guys like Billy Cobham? Well, as most of you know, Billy Cobham is a drummer, and there's only been really one instance that I worked with another drummer in a recording situation, and there were two drummers on a date, and that was Bitches Brew. I worked with Jack DeJohnette, and we both played on, I mean, a lot of people ask me about that album, and they say, well, what tunes did you play on? Because I see that there's two or three different drummers on there, but I played on every tune. We played together. It just sounds like one drummer playing. We both played together. But it's great. I mean, if I have the opportunity to play with Billy on a recorded situation, I'd love it. You know, I think, again, all of the stuff that I talked about playing with rhythm section or whatever, I'd have to adapt all that stuff because, like, there would be two people playing, and we'd have to get it to mesh so it would sound like one, you know. But yeah, I would like to do that. Hello. You should speak a little bit louder. I know I have the microphone, and it's unfair, but what are the instruments that I listen to help form the way that I play my instrument, play drums? Well, I listen to a lot of stylists, a lot of different musicians that play different instruments. I listen to Miles Davis. I listen to John Coltrane, Herbie Hancock. I listened to Orestes Villato, who plays timbales. I listened to Chipito, who played timbales with Santana. I listened to John McLaughlin. I listened to George Benson. I listened to a lot of different people that play different instruments as opposed to playing the drum set. Yeah, I listened to a lot. Those people. I listened to James Brown's music an awful lot. James Brown and Jimi Hendrix. I listened to their music an awful lot, you know. Okay? Go ahead. When did I first? Let me see. The first time I had confidence in myself. Well, I think the confidence really. It was there, but I think. Maybe in the past 5 years, have put a fix on really what it was that was messing me up. It didn't have anything to do with my ability to play the instrument. Again, it was attitude. It was things outside of playing music. I would get to the point where I'd play a drum solo or whatever, and I'd feel intimidated. Because I would feel that somebody out there would say, oh man, his technique is horrible or whatever. And then I just got past that point. I said, man, if my technique is horrible and these people are coming to see me play and they're paying their $5 to get in here, they must be the fools. Not me. I'm up on the stage, you know. So evidently I was doing something right. I don't know, but I think that I say within the last 5 years, I really got to the point. I would let things like the press bother me. I never got any press. I never won any drum polls or anything. And I got past, I got to the point where I said, man, that doesn't really matter. There's more to life than winning a drum poll, you know. So I think in the past 5 years, you know. Your question. Well, yeah, he asked me when I was coming up, did I make up exercises or whatever when I was, you know, wanted to practice certain things. I was fortunate enough to live in New York City where I could see all the best drummers in the world come and play. Unfortunately, I wasn't old enough to go into the clubs, so I had to look through the window. You know, like if you stand outside, it'd be freezing, man. But like the guy be playing, you'd be like, yeah. But, and what would happen is I'd see them do something and I would go home and try to emulate it. Or I would hear it on a record. And a lot of times, I'll give you an example. I would hear Tony Williams play on a record. And I would love the way his cymbal ride sounded. I mean, he'd play in like a beat, like you could hear every note. It wouldn't be shh. So what I would do is I took my cymbal and went, you know, into a corner, you know, like the corner of a room where the walls met, so that like I could harness the sound, and I would play nothing but my cymbal, and I would practice playing a ride and practice playing it evenly and articulately, so that I could hear every beat of what I played. I mean, and I would practice that time and time day. I mean, nothing else but this, no drums, just sit flat-footed and play the cymbal. And I practiced that. And then I went and I actually saw him play. And that really opened my eyes up because I said, oh, that's what he's doing. That's what it is. And then when I listened to the record again, I could visualize, you know, like you visualize what you saw. And you hear him play it on the record. And you say, oh, that was great. And then I adapted it to the rest of the drum set. And a lot of times I'd go play that music where I know people would be watching me. You know, like I know there would be drummers or somebody sitting around and they really scrutinize you, you know, they watch you and they say, yeah, I'm gonna wait till he makes a mistake, you know, I'm gonna check him out. And they sit and watch you. And I would purposely not play anything but the cymbal. And they say, man, why is he doing that? Is that something new? Is that something new? Why is he doing that? You know, and like this is just stuff that I had practiced and I was trying it out. But I felt, again, back to you, I felt confident enough to try it, you know, because I wasn't worried about what the guy thought. So I'd practice certain things, and like I would practice them until I got them. And you know, that was an example, like playing on the ride and nothing else, I would do that. Does that answer your question? Okay. Well, I guess I would advise you to go to music school. More so than that, I would advise you to not only study the drums, but study the keyboards, because keyboards are a percussive instrument, and you have harmony and theory right at your fingertips. And I read a very disturbing quote from a very close friend of mine who plays guitar, who used to play in a band that I was in, who plays guitar. I won't mention his name, but he said that drummers don't really have a melodic attitude. They really don't hear things melodically. Now, what kind of a stupid quote is that? I mean, maybe the drummers that he's been playing with recently are not melodic. But again, man, I must emphasize, these are all old stigmas about drummers. You know, okay, the drum set is a indeterminable pitch, but you can tune them to be, you know, sound like a note. And it's not tuning your drums to a note that makes it sound melodic, it's the way you play that makes it sound melodic. And by going to school and learning about chords and harmonies and structure, that would help you play melodically. I mean, if it's an effort for you to do it on your own. So, I mean, I guess I would advise you to go to school. That is a problem. That really is a problem because, again, the teaching methods are kind of archaic to a degree. There are a lot of good teaching methods. I'm not saying that, you know, in general they are archaic. There are a lot of good ones. But, I mean, just the ones that I've seen and, like, people ask me about, you know, and I hear them say, yeah, well, you should go to this school, And then I go there and I see what they teach, and it's kind of weird, you know. But then that's my personal opinion. You know. Tuning my drums? Well, I usually tune them to an augmented chord. I also found that in tuning your instrument, if you may tune it to a determinable pitch, the drum, it may not feel right. You know, it sounds good. Oh man, they sound real good. But it doesn't feel right. You don't get the response that you want from the drum. So I think you have to have a happy medium between tuning it for the response and tuning it for the sound. And, you know, that's something that, like, you work out on your own, is personal preference, you know. Thank you for the short novel. That was great. I'll answer your second question first, because that is very, very important. It's all about learning the music business, which we could have another seminar on. But situation is, any time that you write a piece of music, right, and you put it on a cassette, right, it's copywritten. Any time that you do that, what you should do is actually put the date that you did it and put it on that cassette. It'll hold up in any court of law. Now, but it is the proper procedure to take your music and have it copywritten before you send it to anybody, because there's been time and time, countless numbers of occasions where a guy plays something, say, hey man, let me play this tune for you. Oh, that's really nice. Okay, I'll see you later. 6 months later, you hear it on the radio. Yo, man, that's my tune. You can't do anything about it, you know? So you should copyright your music. Now, as opposed to living in Memphis and moving to LA or wherever, I don't know. I don't live in Memphis. I really couldn't say how it operates here, but I know at one point this was like the record capital. I know that there's a whole lot of music coming out of here, and it might have shifted to LA or shifted to LA or whatever. But you don't necessarily have to live in that area to get your music heard. Not speaking personally or anything, but like you have to think, is your music good enough to be heard? You know, if you have some music and you write it and you put it down on a cassette and give it to somebody, and it doesn't get past that guy says, yeah, I'll listen, I'll take it and I'll give it to somebody, and he doesn't like it, then like it will never get to that person, whether he's in New York or whatever, or in LA. Or you may write a piece of music, put it on the cassette and send it to New York or send it to LA. And let me tell you what those guys do, man. They got like a pile of cassettes about as high as the ceiling on their desk. And they say, okay, no, I don't like that. And they throw it away. And that's just the reality of the music business, you know. So I don't mean to be down to sound down or whatever about it, but that's the reality of it. I mean, you should get it together where you know, personally in your heart, that it's the best that you can do. And you know that even if he doesn't like it, I know that it's happening. I mean, like when you put your heart into something and you put it on a cassette and send it out to somebody, then you know you're going to get results from it. But if you say, oh yeah, this is something that I like and blah, 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 and this is pretty nice, and you send it to him, and you don't get any results, you know. Did I answer your question? I know that was a short novel, but like, you know. Answer your question? Okay. Well, to be honest, the analytical approach, I mean, to analyze what I played 5-4 against 4-4, that's for you to do. I don't ever do that. I don't count what if I had to sit and count what I played or think about what I played, I would never get to play it. Because that's the barrier. You know, you get to that point and you're playing and you're thinking about this phrase or you're thinking about this rudiment that's coming up and it goes, yeah, right. And you get right there and you never get past it because you're thinking about it or you're counting it. You're counting to that point. And when you're counting to that point, everything else around you, you lose your attention span on everything else around you because you're counting to get to that point, that one lick that you've been saving up for the whole song and you're gonna play it, you know? So I never really count when I'm playing. I play a pattern and I know what the pattern is and I hold fast to that pattern or play around that pattern, but I always know where the one of that pattern is. It's all quarter notes, like when it's 5-4 time, 7-4 time, 16-13 time, it's all quarter notes. And as long as you know where one is, that's the answer. But I don't count. I mean, I don't ever analyze what I do. It's in my head. It's in my head, yeah. Did I answer your question? Sure, I think all of that is concept. The way you sound is your concept. But you play the instrument, the other instrument doesn't play you. If you're playing on cardboard boxes, you have to make the cardboard boxes sound good, you know. I have a preference. These are ambassador weight clear heads. They're not CS heads. CS heads are the heads with the dot on it. And CS stands for controlled sound, and I control the sound, as opposed to the sound being controlled for me. If I want to hit it harder, I hit it harder. If I want to make it choke, I'll do that. Stick-wise, I use 5As and the Regal Tip plastic 5As. I think that these are the most adaptable sticks. I can play hard, fast, slow, and any kind of music that I want to play. They're not too big, you know, they ain't baseball bats. And they're not toothpicks, you know. So, I mean, they're comfortable for me. Yeah. Cool? Answer your question? Okay. Right, no, right, brother with the glasses. Jazz fusion. Jazz fusion, okay. Well, what we can do is we can decipher, we can break it down and actually look at the two words. Okay, jazz. Now you know what jazz music is, right? Okay, well not traditional jazz music. I mean, jazz music is Duke Ellington, Count Basie, Charlie Parker, Dizzy Gillespie. That's jazz music, really. Lester Young, you know. That's jazz music, Louis Armstrong. Now fusion is just, you know, putting two musical styles together. In the late 60s, early 70s is when jazz fusion started to happen. And what that was combining musicians that had a jazz background and opening up the music and playing with electronic instruments. And combining that with people that had a primarily rock background. So you had the fusion of rock music and jazz music, improvising. You got the improvising and the phrasing from jazz and the power, energy, and electricity from the rock music. So together you get jazz fusion. I mean, like, and it's evolved. That's just my definition. It's evolved since then and it's gotten kind of complex, but that's my concept? You mean what I'm playing now? What I'm playing now isn't jazz fusion. What I'm playing... Plug. What I'm playing on the new album here is... This new album with the smiling guy here and these other various people here, this is not jazz fusion. This is what I call progressive pop music with an R&B bass. This is where I am now. This is what I want to do. I've learned a lot from playing a lot of different kinds of music, and I feel comfortable playing this. And it's a new challenge, a new direction, and it's different. So I call it pro-pop. What does it consist of? It consists of popular music, vocals, and progressive chord changes and progressive rhythms. It consists of, you know, those two things. Do I mix? Yes. In recording, I don't have to answer to the producer mixing my drums or telling me what to play because I am the producer. So if I mess up, it's on me. You know, if the album sounds bad, people come back to me and say it sounds bad. Yeah. I can't hear you. Does what come with patterns? Mm-hmm. Both. I mean, like, we have patterns that, like, we design our tunes around, and, you know, we play those patterns with feeling. I can't correlate. I don't know what you mean by when we first started playing. You mean as a group? Uh-huh. Oh, yeah. I always play with patterns. I play with patterns as opposed to counting the particular type of music or phrasing or whatever. I play with patterns in my head. Yeah. Same two guys. What, you guys want to fight? Yeah. Okay. First off, no, there's nothing wrong with playing disco. Are you a musician? Okay, well, but I mean, the definition of a musician is somebody that plays music. And it really doesn't mean somebody that plays that type of music. That type of music. Again, we're getting down to attitudes. You have an attitude about a particular type of music. So you got a guy that you really loved and he played this way and now he's playing something else and you don't like it. Listen. Well, maybe you should go talk to him about that. I'll give you his number. You call him up and say, "Yo, Stanley, man, I don't think what you're playing is from your heart." And man, and like, really, man, you're wasting your time playing that music. And you should play some of the music that you played before, right? No. Stanley doesn't play disco. He's not playing disco. I think you have your terms crossed. I don't think he's not playing disco now. You know, you have to really find out what you mean by disco. He's not playing disco to me. And Stanley's a great bass player and a good friend of mine. So whatever he wants to do, he'll do. I don't hold anything against him for playing a particular way. You know. Hmm. Let me emphasize this, because there's a real big fallacy about playing a certain way and making a lot of money, you know. No. I'm not here to find fault with you at all. I just like to explain something so that, like, you know what it is. Just because you turn around and play something which you think is disco does not mean that you're going to make any money at all. I mean, if a person chooses to do that, I mean, an artist is always constantly growing. It's always a challenge to do something different. And you should really let him do that. And, you know, like, it's okay if he does it. And, like, a lot of times, it's hard for people to grow with an artist. And if an artist wants to change and play another particular type of music, you should let him do that. It's okay that you liked what he did in the past, and you still have those records to refer to. It's not like you can't hear that again, because you can hear it again, because there are those records that are there. But it's so hard when a guy puts his life into playing an instrument, and then he chooses to play another type of music, and his fans don't support him. I mean, because it's you people that really make the artist. Fine, the guy can play, but I mean, if you don't support him, then, you know, he's going to wind up playing in his basement or being a postman, you know, being a mailman or whatever, because he's not going to play his instrument anymore because you don't support him. But I'm not saying, I'm not forcing you to support Stanley Clarke because what he's playing now is what you don't like. What I'm saying is that, like, you should, like, really have a clear head about it. And it's okay to do that. Yeah, it is okay to play disco music. And what I'm playing on this album is not disco music. Okay. I can't hear you. Is my set wide open? I don't know what you mean by wide open. Oh, yeah, oh, no. No, there are no muffles, except for on the bass drum. You know, playing live, if you hit a drum and, like, you know, there's echo, there's going to be a natural echo, a natural resonance. But no, I don't use any dampers on my drums or tape or anything. That's an unfair question, because whatever I say is going to influence what you feel, right? Oh, okay. I think he's great. Oh, I think he's great. But he wouldn't play in my band. No. No, I think he's great. I really do. I think he's great. Hey, oh, whoa, can I sit down? Okay. Oh, you finished? Oh, okay. I mean, I didn't know. It's very loose. Very loose. Another thing that I normally do is, if this is the bass drum head, right, and your bass drum pedal is like this, and you hit it, you know, like this is the bass drum head, and this is flush, right? If the bass drum was like this and the bass drum pedal is like that, when you hit it, usually it's at an angle like that. What I do is I tilt the front head of the bass drum up so that the bass drum is at an angle like this, so the arc between where the pedal is and where it hits is shorter. You know, it's like this, there's that much distance, and it's like that, there's that much distance. It's a little shorter. I don't know. You know, that's not for me to decide. If it happens, it happens. I know I did do a record with Stanley. Stanley and I played on a record with Larry Coryell, and it's not out yet. I don't know if it'll ever be out. I don't know. But we did it back in May of this year, so maybe it'll be released soon. Not anymore. I don't do that many sessions anymore because I'm primarily working on producing my band and trying to get that together. Yeah. Two more questions. by somebody who has an aunt. Young lady. Are you a teacher? I mean, because that's a great question. I mean, and like you. Because you kind of answered the question in your question. No, I'm serious. I mean, it was a good question. Definitely. You're 100%. I think that you do have to go back and find the roots. And once you get back and get the roots, then you can adapt that to what you do today. I think that, like, once you do that, you will find that out of whatever errors, you'll take whatever out, and it'll be personal. And, like, you'll get your own personal stamp from doing that, from going back and listening to all the different... because, you know, you have the access to do that. I mean, like, recorded music, it's all there. You know, you can listen to the guy, you can listen to Baby Dodge, you can listen to Philly Joe Jones and Max Roach, you can listen to that. You know, like, that's really a gift. No, you're 100% right. You're absolutely right. You should go back and learn your roots and find out where all of this music originated from, where it came from. And then you can decipher and see how it developed to where it is now. That's a perfect question, and you answered the question in your question. But, like, that's a good answer. But no, they were real good questions. And once again, thank you. And I hope to come back and do it again real soon. Thank you. Oh, you got to thank the guys, too. You got to thank the guys, man. Thank the guys, too.
Before you go, Lenny will be down at this table here in about 5 or so minutes if you want to get an autograph on anything you got there.